السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. So welcome to the final episode of a 25-part series on how the Quran teaches us to behave. And I don't think there's a better way to end this series except with this beautiful verse in Surah Az-Zumar, in where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us and actually speaks to his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and says to him, قُلْ Say to them, يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ To the slaves that have wronged themselves. Basically, who have sinned, who have done certain things that, you know, they shouldn't have done. They fell into error, they fell into mistake. And this ayah is really about the opportunity to recover and hope with your Creator, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I think that this is a beautiful way to end these series, because at the end of the day, all of the things that we've talked about in 24, 25 episodes, at the end of the day, it's a decision that you have to make of whether or not you're willing to put the work that's involved in order to practice and achieve the things that these verses are calling us to do. And remember, going back to the first episode, we introduced this subject about how the Quran teaches us to behave, that this is something that we welcome as believers. We want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us. We want Him to give us clarity and direction in our life, give us purpose. So the fact that Allah teaches us how to conduct ourselves as believers in every day, in all aspects, in just whatever circumstances, is actually a blessing and an incredible mercy from Him that He subhanahu wa ta'ala would do that for us. And so this particular verse just kind of takes a little bit of all the lessons that we've talked about and summarize it beautifully so that you always find hope, that you see direction, that you see that there is light at the end of the tunnel, that despite whatever your relationship is with Allah, if any, even if it doesn't exist, but you've always had that desire, that will in the back of your mind, in your heart, that you want to do certain things for the sake of Allah, but for whatever reason, you just haven't been able to do that. Hopefully this verse would really give you that last push that you need and things start to improve. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ Those who have wronged, who have crossed barriers and boundaries within themselves. So you were given limitations to follow certain rules. That's ayat and hadith. But unfortunately, for whatever reason, you've gone above and beyond that. So now we went into territory that we're really not supposed to be in. This is part of that, or part of that journey is when we sin and make those mistakes. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tell us to do in this case? لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ Don't you dare lose hope in the mercy of Allah. Now the word that's used here is تَقْنَطُوا from قَنَطَ. قَنَطَ literally is don't allow your mind, your heart for a split moment to lose that connection and that hope with Allah. We know we can't see Him. We can't literally speak to Him, that we can hear a voice, we can get that reassurance. We know that there is that limited connection, and a lot of this relies on faith and a lot of the things that we study and we learn through our journey in studying the Quran and the Sunnah of our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. But with that being said, when you take all of that knowledge together and everything that we do in our day-to-day lives of praying and worship, etc., this is where hope comes alive. You know, very often we lose hope because we're surrounded by people who have lost hope as well. We hear things that's negative. We hear khutbas and lectures and sermons and reminders that are always pointing at their fingers, that are always pointing at the mistakes and errors of people. Very, very often this happens. And what that does is that it creates this atmosphere and this attitude in the believer that, you know, the only interaction that they have with Allah's book is, if I don't follow the instructions here, I'm going to get punished. I'm going to go to the hellfire. Something terrible is going to happen. You know, it really frustrates me because the Prophet ﷺ was a Bashir. He was a man that came with glad tidings, with good news and hope. But then he was also Nadir as well. He also came to warn. The point is, he had a balance of two of these extremes. On both ends of the coin, he was able to do both. Often, unfortunately, so many talks and lectures and reminders are only focused on Nadir. Warning people, don't do this. This is what's happened. And sometimes it comes off in a condescending way. Sometimes it comes off in a way that makes people that are listening to this stuff feel bad and they lose inspiration. They start losing hope within themselves. The Quran is not like that. The Quran, the majority of its instructions are positive. And it's very sporadic throughout the Quran where Allah talks about punishment. He talks about adhabun aleem, that it would be painful, and describes some of that in detail. But that's not what the entire message is revolved around. It's surrounded more so with positive verses of hope, encouragement to inspire you, to give you the wisdom, knowledge, to make sound decisions, all of these wonderful things. And so we should keep that pattern, that focus, and that discipline in our own lives. We should always turn things that may seem negative and pessimistic into something positive, into something hopeful. This ayah is encouraging and instructing us that the starting point to all of that is, look, whatever you do in your life, even though Allah might not be sitting beside you, He may not be there talking to you in terms of you hearing His voice, etc. Maybe that's not happening, because usually hope is surrounded or at least is influenced by the people that can encourage and interact with you and give you some sense of hope. Fine, we don't have that direct link with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but from a spiritual sense, we do. And it's about keeping that hope alive through faith, through worship, through prayer, study, knowledge. All of these things help us to build that hope that we need so that we can gain the confidence we need that at the most difficult times, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we need Him the most, He is always there. And He tells us this Himself, that He's always there to respond. Ud'uni astajib lakum. Whenever you call upon Me, I'm always here to respond. So this is why Allah makes it very firm. There's no exception to it, really, is that whatever you do in your life, as long as you've wronged yourself, don't ever lose hope in the sight with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله, especially and particularly with His mercy. إن الله يغفر الذنوب جميعا. This is just amazing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then continues to say, indeed Allah forgives sins, all of them, jami'a, every single one of them. You know, humans, we may not forgive one another. We'll have limitations. You know, I forgive you, but except that one time you said or you did so and so. So we have limitations, but this overall unconditional acceptance and forgiveness, nobody is able to do that more so than the source of forgiveness, Al-Ghafoor, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself. And He tells us, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا, gives us that reassurance with إِنَّ. إِنَّ is a term that comes in this ayah and comes throughout the Qur'an as well to emphasize, to give reassurance. In other words, just as you've gained the confidence in not losing hope in Me, that same confidence and determination, carry that in the fact that when you turn to Allah and you ask Him for forgiveness, that He'll actually forgive you, and leave it at that. And this is how the Quran starts to encourage us to be positive, to have that self-confidence from within, that at the end of the day, no matter how messed up our lives can be, no matter how terrible the things you might have said or done, it doesn't matter. We are not more superior than the mercy and forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If He says He will do it, He will do it. And hopefully throughout this series, we've been able to encourage you to find that strength and find that confidence that Allah jalla wa ala will actually forgive us. And we all have that ability to do that. Because why? We've said this before in some of our previous episodes. As long as we are alive, the institute of forgiveness and tawbah is always open. As long as we are here. And so the fact that Allah put us alive in this day and age in 2020, it shows that we all have what it takes, that anything that is given to us and presented to us in our lives, we have what it takes to get through and cope with that and see the other side and go above the hill and see the other side of hope and forgiveness. So it's actually quite beautiful. But to discover this beauty, there has to be this consistent relationship with your Creator. You have to be connected with Him so that when you do turn to Him, He will always be listening because you've had that consistent relationship. And even logically, this makes sense. I'm not going to help somebody I barely know, that I barely talk to, who rarely connects with me. And so it's kind of the same idea that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help us in our difficult times as long as we keep a connection with Him during the easy times. So Allah Azza wa Jal tells us, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Indeed, He is the one that is exceptionally forgiving, always merciful. Those of you that study Arabic, you know what ghafur is. It's mubalagha. What that means is that when Allah does forgive, which He will not always forgive, because we have to earn that, we have to follow instructions, we have to do certain things to qualify to gain Allah's forgiveness. So not everybody will get that. But when it does happen, and inshallah ta'ala, we will all have that. When Allah does forgive, He says ghafoor, which means He will forgive it all. So He's exceptionally forgiving. But then Allah uses another word that's always, it always seems like it's the sister word to forgiveness in the Quran. Every time you hear ghafoor, usually what follows after is rahim. Rahim, it's not the same as ghafoor. It doesn't say ruhum, okay? Rahim is very different. Rahim now is Allah is always forgiving, meaning the doors of mercy, the doors of mercy is always wide open, but the doors of forgiveness, they have their time and place. Sometimes it would be closed depending on what we're doing or not doing. But most of the times when it is open, understand that Allah will allow all sins and all mistakes and He will be willing to forgive everything. So that's an exceptional moment for the believer. But when it comes to His mercy, this is how we fuse the two together. The mercy that is always there is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always willing to forgive. That's His mercy. So when we put this together, the reflection of Allah's mercy is the fact that He is willing to forgive us of all of our sins. And that's just a beautiful thing. So, in conclusion, with this series and everything that we've said and everything that we've shared, this is an opportunity for us to really take a moment, even after this video or sometime during the day, just take a moment to really make that one dua that's life-changing, that one prayer that you know can have a meaningful impact, that you're not just doing the exercise, but you're praying and you just select one of those prayers, and that's a starting point. You don't just focus on that one prayer and all your concentration, all your efforts are devoted to that one salah, but it's a starting point. And make that one prayer meaningful, and you'll notice that if you do that once, you'll say to yourself, you know, I can probably do this again. Let me try it with the next prayer and the next prayer. And before you know it, that's how you get the ball rolling. And that's how we become candidates to Allah's exceptional forgiveness. But the doors of mercy, the willingness that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to allow us to have that opportunity to make the mistakes and then still turn to Him and say, oh Allah, I messed up again. And again, and again. That's Allah's mercy. He says, okay, it's fine. Just as long as you turn to me, as long as you remember me, you make your mistakes, okay, fine. Just make that one dua. Do the one thing. Do the things that you need to do. So that when I judge you and I'm ready to forgive you, I will forgive everything and anything that you've done. This is something that human beings can't even do with one another. So it just shows how the magnitude and just the level of forgiveness and love that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has for His creation. And this is really important. When you study a little bit of the Arabic, even just basic Arabic, you open up a brand new world. It's as if you're studying the Quran all over again. And just because of how rich the language and comprehensive the language is, it really helps you to try to reflect and imagine for a moment. And that's when you realize, I don't have the ability to really truly understand the magnitude of Allah's love and forgiveness for us. And like I said, to be able to talk this way, to be able to say this with confidence that I know Allah is there to forgive me, I know that Allah is there to have mercy on me, I feel that and I can connect with that and I have full confidence in that. To get to that place, it requires for us to do all of the dirty work. So to really push ourselves against temptation. You know, it's hard to pray 5 times a day because you literally have to stop your day at least 5 times and do this ritual. But you do it anyway. It's a struggle. Sometimes, you know, the Dhuhr Salah is not the same as the Asr Salah. And then one other Salah, it's like, man, I don't even know what I just prayed. And it's been like this. And every other day you have these moments. And forget about Fajr. We can't even talk about Fajr. You know, for a lot of us, we probably don't even remember the last time we woke up on time for Fajr. But the point is, you keep trying. You keep working at that. You, no matter how awful it might feel and the experience might feel, you don't give up. And that's what Allah is saying. Don't you dare give up on me. وَأَنِيبُوا إِلَىٰ رَبِّكُمْ. So the next verse, Allah says, turn back to me. Why? Because you left me this whole time. I'm right here. I'm always willing to forgive. My doors of mercy were always open to you. So just come back to it. It's okay. Sometimes we lose track. Sometimes we fall off the wagon. But get back on. And that's what these ayat are telling us and giving us the hope, the strength that we can do that. Allah doesn't give no exception. He doesn't say, okay, turn back to me except if you are. No. No matter what your case is, just come back to me. وَأَنِيبُوا إِلَىٰ رَبِّكُمْ. But this time, learn from your mistakes. Then Allah says, وَأَسْلِمُوا لَهُ. And just accept Him. So in other words, learn that, okay, you doubted Allah for some time, you lost hope in Allah for some time, you lost that confidence in Allah's instructions for some time, whatever the case is. Now learn from that and reconnect, and this time completely and fully submit yourself. Because that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves from all of us. And so with that being said, I once again want to thank each and every one of you for your support and listening to this. There have been many of you that have tuned in every single day live, but those of you who couldn't, you were watching this and sharing it, and I've been seeing all of that on my page. And I just want to say that exactly what the Prophet ﷺ taught us to do, that whoever does not show gratitude to the people does not show gratitude to Allah. And so I certainly, after thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the strength to do this, I want to also extend my gratitude and thank you to all of you for supporting this effort. And it's very encouraging, to be honest with you. Usually, as a da'i and as a speaker, you do a series for an extended period. And when you start to see that connection is slowly diminishing, you start to get discouraged. But that didn't happen with any of you. The engagement was real. People were talking. We were asking questions. These are the things that we live for, brothers and sisters. These are the moments that we want, that we can share something beneficial with one another, but we can create that connection and that engagement. And so I pray that Allah Azza wa Jal gives us the strength that we continue to do that. I do have a brand new series that I'm going to start tomorrow, insha'Allah ta'ala. I thought to myself I wanted to introduce that series in this video, but I think it'll be a better option that we conclude our thoughts and everything with this series and just keep it with this series and this title. I don't want to jump in or at least add something of another series into this one, so we'll keep them separate. So basically what I'm saying, long story short, is you're going to have to wait at least about 24 hours or so for my brand new series, insha'Allah ta'ala. And I promise you, it is something to look forward to. It's a beautiful subject. It's rarely talked about, but it's meaningful and it's relatable. And it doesn't matter what your age is, what your background is, where you are in the world. It doesn't matter how much knowledge you have or don't have. this brand new series is going to be relative to you. And I pray that Allah Azza wa Jal gives me the strength to start it and to continue it and to finish it, inshaAllah ta'ala. Remember, brothers and sisters, my goal is everything that I teach in my life, my goal is to inspire and encourage people to have confidence that no matter what they are, what they say or what they do or what they feel themselves to be, that they have what it takes to always improve. And that's the mindset that I carry when I teach something, is I want my audience and I want my students to feel that no matter how messed up you think you are, you have what it takes to be the best Muslim that you can be, a Muslim that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is proud of, bi-ithnillahi ta'ala. Take this last example, and that's what I leave you with, inshaAllah. Always remember that there were sahabas that were the worst human beings before Islam. And those same companions, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam would walk up to them after they became Muslim, would walk up to them and say to them, you're going to Jannah. Allah just told me, you're also going to paradise. Allah just told me, you got forgiven. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu tried to assassinate the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah buried Umar beside the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, the same man he tried to assassinate. There's always hope. No matter what we say, no matter what we do, no one has a clue what the next day will look like. And so it's very, very beautiful that we can share some of these thoughts together. And I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the strength to always and forever do that. Allahumma ameen. So once again, jazakumullahu khairan. Thank you all for your support and look forward to a brand new topic, a brand new series coming to you, inshaAllah ta'ala, tomorrow, bi-ithnillah. I don't have a specific time when I do this, so if you're on live, you're on live. Otherwise, it'll be posted on the page and you're welcome to take a look at it at your convenience. Jazakumullahu khairan, everyone. May Allah Azza wa Jal bless you all, keep you safe, and continue to teach us this beautiful way of life, al-Islam. Allahumma ameen. Jazakumullahu khairan. Thank you. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.